Massimo is the K.D. Ironic Professor of Philosophy at the City College of New York, and he has a PhD in Evolutionary Biology from the University of Connecticut, as well as a PhD in Philosophy from the University of Tennessee. His interests include the philosophy of science, the relationship between science and philosophy, the nature of pseudoscience, and of course, the practical philosophy of Stoicism. And he's going to speak to us on the topic, Stoic Exercises to Thrive in a World Out of Your Control, which seems to be very much what we're experiencing now. So what can you tell us, Massimo?
Thanks, Richard. That was very nice of you. Yeah, you wouldn't believe how popular Stoicism is these days. It's all of a sudden people are discovering that, guess what? The world really is largely outside of our control. And it's something that, of course, we always know. You know, if you reflect for a couple of minutes, you realize that the limit of human agency is in fact fairly strict, even on a normal basis. There are only so many things that are up to us, and most, a lot of stuff it's not. But under these conditions, the message really does come home very, very sharply. So what I'd like to do today is a very brief introduction to sort of the basic ideas of Stoicism. Some of you may have heard the basics already, so I apologize for the redundancy, but I'd like to bring everybody up to speed on the topic. And then we're going to go through three examples. I'm going to select three exercises that I find particularly useful these days when I'm stuck mostly at home with, you know, long days of, you know, 12 hours a day where I had to figure out how to use my time properly. So let me start with the basics. So Stoicism, of course, is an ancient Greek and Roman philosophy. It started around 300 BCE with a guy named Zeno of Citium. Zeno was a merchant, and he was on his way to Athens, and he had a shipwreck. And he lost pretty much everything in there. Talk about things that are outside of your control. And so he makes it to Athens, however he survives, makes it to Athens. And of course, the first thing that he does is what everybody would do after a shipwreck. He goes to a bookstore. And, you know, and he starts talking to the owner and reading books, you know, going through books. And he was reading, in fact, the second volume, apparently, of Xenophon's Memorabilia, which is a biography of Socrates, which survived to these days, actually. We can check it out. And Zeno was so taken by this thing that he turns to the bookseller and says, where can I find me one of these people, meaning a philosopher? And the bookseller says, well, there's one walking right outside of the shop right now, so, you know, follow him, because again, Athens was the place where you of course find philosophers walking around, you know, near bookstores. So Zeno follows this guy that turned out to be Critias of Tibis, who was a Cynic philosopher. The word did not mean at the time what it means today, but I'm not going to go into it. And so he starts studying philosophy. He eventually also studies with a number of other philosophers in Athens, including Plato's Academy, although Plato had been dead by that time. And finally, he starts teaching on his own. And he starts teaching in a very public place, right outside of the Agora. The Agora was the ancient Athenian marketplace. And in this place called the Stoa Poikile, which means painted porch. It was basically a colonnade that was open for people to walk in and talk to each other and things like that. And that's where the name Stoicism comes, because they started teaching in the Stoa. This is significant because from the beginning means that Stoicism was addressed to everyday people, to anybody who might walk outside in the marketplace, as opposed to most of the other schools like Plato's Academy or Aristotle's Lyceum or Epicurus' Garden, who were actually outside of town and they were kind of isolated, secluded on purpose. You know, you had to apply to actually get in. So that's how Stoicism got started. It became very popular in ancient Greece and then throughout the Roman Empire. And it can be, the philosophy itself can be summarized in a couple of ways. First of all, what is the goal? Well, the goal of Stoicism is to allow us to become the best human beings we can possibly be. The word that the Stoics used was arete, which is Greek for broadly speaking, virtue. But virtue really means excellence. Arete really means excellence. So the idea is to make ourselves into the best human beings that we can. Not the perfect human beings, because very few people get to perfection, if any, but certainly the best that we can. That's the goal. And how do you do this? How do you achieve this? Well, the Stoics said that the way to become the best human being you can is by to live according to nature. And living according to nature is a kind of a strange phrase. It may bring to mind images of people running naked into the woods, but that's not what it is. It basically means live according to the best of human nature. And the best of human nature for the Stoics is the fact that we are highly social animals. We thrive only in social groups and in communication with others, in interaction with others. And we all realize during these particular times just how important, in fact, social communications are. There are like more than 100 people in this virtual room, for instance. So we need to be social. And the other thing that we have that characterizes us as a species is the ability to reason through our problems. And so to live according to nature means to apply reason to make life better, particularly social life better. So the goal is to become the best human being you can. And the way you do that is by applying reason to improve society in whatever way you can. Right? So those are the basic ideas. Now, the exercises that I selected come from a book that I published recently with my friend and collaborator, Greg Lopez. The book is called A Handbook for New Stoics. And actually it contains a whopping 52 exercises, each one of which is taken from one of the ancient sources, and it is updated with modern science. We checked about, you know, what does cognitive science or psychology or behavioral science tell us about the efficacy of these kind of techniques. So this is all techniques that are meant, each one of which is meant to deal with one aspect of your life and or social life in general. However, before we get to the exercises themselves, I need to give you a little bit of background about the guy that mostly, the ancient philosopher that Greg and I mostly use, although not exclusively, for these exercises. And his name was Epictetus. He's one of the least famous of the Stoics, at least in terms of general public. Most people know of Seneca. He was the advisor to the Emperor Nero. He had to commit suicide when it turned out that he may have been involved in a conspiracy against Nero. Most people know Marcus Aurelius, the emperor philosopher who wrote the Meditations. But Epictetus is not exactly a household name, although things are changing and he's becoming more and more recognizable. Epictetus was a slave was brought to Rome, in fact, it was a contemporary Seneca, so to the court of the Emperor Nero. Eventually, he was a brilliant guy, and he was freed by his master, and he studied philosophy in Rome, and eventually started teaching philosophy. In fact, he was teaching the kind of philosophy that was speaking truth to power, so to speak. And so he got really on the nerves of a couple of emperors until Domitian, two emperors after Nero, sent Epictetus into exile. And Epictetus went to northwestern Greece in a place called Nicopolis, where he restarted his school. Epictetus had a particular brand of Stoicism, which I think is very useful. And the best way probably to understand Epictetus' approach to Stoicism is to talk about his famous three disciplines. He thought that there are three areas of life, I suppose, where we need to get better, to improve. And these areas give the names to the three disciplines. The three disciplines are desire, action, and assent. Desire, the discipline of desire, means that often we tend to desire the wrong things or things that are not good for us. Too much food, too much drinking, spending too much money shopping or something like that. And we don't actually focus our attention. We don't actually turn our attention to things that we should be desiring, such as improving ourselves, having good relations with other people, and so on and so forth. So the discipline of desire is a series of exercises, comprised of a series of exercises to, in a sense, retune our desires, to move away from stuff that we shouldn't really embrace and to move toward things that we really should be embracing. But that's the first one. The second one is the discipline of action. The discipline of action deals with, is concerned with how to deal with other people. Because as I said, we're in a society, we're not individuals, left to our own devices. And so the question, one of the important questions we have to answer is, well, how do we interact with other people? How do we relate to other people? That's the discipline of action. And then the discipline of assent. Assent means agreeing, right, on something. The discipline of assent is about how to improve our judgment. Because according to the Stoics, often we jump to conclusions, we arrive at judgments that are actually not really particularly well thought out. We're too quick to judge situations and people, and often when we do, we actually get it wrong. And so the discipline of assent is essentially meant to improve our ability to arrive at correct judgments whenever possible. And so the three exercises that I'm going to be talking about in the next few minutes have to do our examples from one each for each one of the three disciplines that I just mentioned: desire, action, and assent. So let's start with the discipline of desire. And the exercise, Greg and I call this exercise "Discover what is really under your control and what is not," which is something that, as has been mentioned already a couple of times, we all have to actually deal with very, very much in these times of pandemics. For each exercise, I'm going to read a short quote. As it turns out, all three of these quotes are from Epictetus, and in fact, from a particular book by Epictetus called the Enchiridion, or Manual, or Handbook for How to Live Your Life. And I'll read the quote, and then I'll explain what the quote means and what the exercise actually consists of. So Epictetus says, all of existing things, some are in our power and others are not in our power. In our power are thought, impulse, will to get, and will to avoid, and in a word, everything which is our own doing. Things not in our power include the body, property, reputation, office, and in a word, everything which is not our own doing. What he's saying here is that the human agency is very limited, and pretty much a way to rephrase what I just read is that pretty much the only things that are completely up to us are our own judgments, endorsed values, and decisions to act or not to act. Okay. So when we say this is a good thing, well, that's a judgment, and it's a value that we endorse, or this is a bad thing, that's a judgment that we endorse. That's up to us. Nobody else can force us. Other people, of course, can influence our judgments for sure. But ultimately, if I state my own opinion and you say, and you challenge me, well, you are right to challenge me because it is my opinion. I can't just say, well, I heard it on TV or I read it in a book. If it is my opinion, I'm the one that is responsible because I'm putting it forth. And that actually is pretty much all that we are completely in control of, according to Epictetus. Everything else, there are things that we can influence, but ultimately don't depend on us. And let me focus in particular on the very first one that Epictetus mentions there, essentially our health, when he says body. Well, of course I can influence my health, right? I can eat healthy even under a pandemic. You know, with my wife, we're trying to be careful and eat, you know, as healthy as possible. And I can exercise even in the middle of a pandemic. We turned out we live in an apartment in Brooklyn that has 16 floors. So I turned the apartment building stairs into a stairmaster, and you know, every day I go up and down the stairs to exercise. So you can do that sort of stuff, right? And of course, when we go out, we're as careful as we can reasonably be in terms of distancing and in terms of then wiping things down when we get back home. Nevertheless, the ultimate outcome is not up to us. We know perfectly well that we could get sick, even though we're doing everything that we can not to. It is very possible that, the virus is pretty sneaky and it's very possible that we're going to get it. Or it's possible that our health is going to suffer in some other way. I mean, we have no idea, right? But obviously one of the side products of this pandemic is that you can't go to the doctor. I mean, the other day I was supposed to have a couple of weeks ago, I was supposed to have a appointment with one of my doctors, and we did it online, like we're doing it right now. But, it's not quite the same thing. She had to do some blood work, and obviously she's not going to be able to do the blood work until this whole thing is over, or at least until there is a respite from it. So who knows? I may have something else that's going on in my body. I have no idea. Right? So all of those things are not up to us. Well, so what does that mean in practice? In practice, this means that according to the Stoics, that we should try to refocus our efforts on the things that are in fact up to us, and then develop an attitude of equanimity, of acceptance for the things that are not up to us. Realizing that external things such as health, wealth, relations with other people, etc., we can work on them, but ultimately sometimes things will go our way and sometimes they won't go our way. And we are adults, we're not children, so we know this. We should keep this in mind. And when things don't go our way, we don't throw a tantrum because we're not children. We just accept it and say, well, better luck next time, you know, I'm going to work on it next time. So in practice, the exercise goes like this. Suppose that you have a challenge, such as, a job interview. People are still doing job interviews via Zoom or similar platforms, right? Even though people are losing a lot of jobs these days. But say that you have to do something like that. It comes natural to us to focus on the outcome. I want the job. But the outcome is one of those things that are not up to us. Again, we can influence them. We can work on it. But ultimately, it is up to the interviewer to decide whether we get the job or not. And that depends on a large number of factors that are certainly not under our control, like who else is applying for the job, or you know, what the mood of the interviewer is that day. Maybe he just got up on the wrong side of the bed and he's in a bad mood and he's not going to react well to whatever we say. So the outcome is not up to us. What is up to us, of course, is the preparation, is to put the best CV possible into place, to focus during the interview, to dress appropriately, even though if you are on Zoom, you don't want to show up in your pajamas and, you know, things like that. So the exercise consists in this. Anytime you have a challenge, large or small as it may be, start thinking about it in this way. Make a two parallel lists. Use a piece of paper or a word processor or whatever. Make two columns, and on one column on the left side, write down things that you think are up to you under this particular situation or with regard to this particular problem. And on the right side, put down things that are not up to you, that ultimately you can influence, but you cannot ultimately control. And then go through the list over and over and repeat to yourself that you should be focusing on the left side of the list and develop an attitude of acceptance for whatever is going to come out in terms of the right list, right? And I find this exercise, I and a lot of other people find this exercise actually very useful because it's calming, it's focusing. It's equivalent essentially in modern psychological terms to internalize your goals. Instead of focusing on the outcome of something, you focus on your own effort, because the efforts are in fact up to you, the outcomes, as I said, are not. The second exercise that I'm going to propose is has to do with the discipline of action, the second discipline, and it has to do, which therefore has to do with other people, to how to deal with other people. This one is one of my favorite exercises. Greg and I called it keep your peace of mind in mind. Here's the quote from the Enchiridion, and then I'm going to explain what it is and how to do the exercise. When you're about to take something in hand, remind yourself what manner of thing it is. If you're going to bathe, put before you your mind what happens in the bath. He's talking about public baths as they used to have them in ancient Rome. Water pouring over some, others being jostled, some reveling, others stealing. And you will set to work more securely if you say to yourself at once, I want to bathe and I want to keep my will in harmony with nature. And so in each thing you do, for in this way, if anything turns up to hinder you in your bathing, you will be ready to say, I did not want only to bathe, but to keep my will in harmony with nature. And I shall not so keep it if I lose my temper at what happens. So what is he talking about? He's talking about a situation that is clearly not entirely under his control. If you don't, if you haven't experienced going to the baths lately, think about going to a movie theater. Don't we all wish that we could go to a movie theater right now? But, you know, think about the old days where you could go into a movie theater. And of course, at least in my experience, what would happen more often than not, that you sit down, the lights go down, the movie starts, and then some jerk in the second row in front of you turn on his cell phone because he absolutely has to post something on Facebook or text somebody else or whatever it is. Apparently not realizing or not caring that the people behind him are actually now not enjoying the movie anymore because they're distracted by the flickering of the phone. This is a situation equivalent to Epictetus going to the baths, right? And when he says, well, whenever you're in that situation, remember that you always have two goals, not just one. One is to enjoy whatever it is that you set out to enjoy. In the case that I just mentioned, you know, you go to the movies, you want to enjoy watching the movie. Now, that's what you paid for, that's what you got together with your friends for, and so on. But at the same time, you should also tell yourself that you also want to keep harmony with nature. What does that mean? It means particularly keep harmony with human nature. In other words, you want to be in a harmonious relationship, both with yourself and with other people. Okay? And if you get upset, if you start losing your temper, that's not going to happen, obviously. And the trick here is, it's the mental trick that Epictetus is advising us to perform, is to go out with these expectations. There is one thing, notice that it's under your control. It's up to you, keeping harmony with nature, keep calm and in harmonious relationship with others. And the other one is not up to you. That's to enjoy your experience at the movies or whatever it is you're doing. This can also be applied, of course, at home, because you don't need to go out to the movies if you're living with other people and you're doing things with other people. And sometimes, let's say dinner together or watching a movie from home together or something like that, right? Well, sometimes that even that simple activity is not necessarily going to go your way, because it's going to be the other person is going to do something and maybe it's going to annoy you, or there's some distraction is coming in and you can't read. You wanted to read your book that evening and you can't read your book because it's a distraction, or somebody else in the apartment next door turns on the music and all of a sudden you can't focus on whatever you were doing, right? The trick in all these situations, again, is to say, well, I wanted to do this, but I knew that was not necessarily under my control, succeeding. On the other hand, I also want to keep in peace and in harmony with my neighbors and my friends, with my family. So that is up to me. In practice, the way this exercise actually works is that you do a sort of a premeditation of the situation. So you think ahead of time. You say, well, what am I about to do tonight? I am about to watch television with my, you know, wife or husband or partner. Well, what's your goal? Well, your goal is to watch and to have a nice time, but also not to get upset and to keep good relation, not only with yourself, but with her or him. And by thinking about it ahead of time, evidence in modern psychology shows that your mind is in fact prepared. And so when something does happen that it's not going to go exactly as you predicted, or something might have been annoying under different circumstances, you say, oh, okay, well, I knew that was possibly going to happen. And you are far better prepared not to get upset, not to lose your temper. The third and last exercise that I wanted to propose is from the discipline of ascent. The discipline of ascent, as I mentioned earlier, has to do with improving our judgment about things. The Stoics thought that we jump to conclusions too often, too quickly, without much of a sort of a background information about people, about situations, and so on and so forth. And so we need to correct that, because that's not good for us, arriving at, you know, incorrect judgments, and it's also not good for our relations with other people. So here's the exercise. Again, it's from a quote. The inspiration comes from a quote from Epictetus in the Enchiridion, and it goes like this. Remember that foul words or blows in themselves are not outrage, but your judgment that they are so. So when anyone makes you angry, know that it is your own thought that has angered you. Wherefore, make it your first endeavor not to let your impressions carry you away. For if once you gain time and delay, you will find it easier to control yourself. So this is about anger management, essentially. And the Stoics were big on anger management. The Stoics thought that anger is the most disruptive negative emotion that human beings can possibly experience. Because when we act on the basis of anger, anger is natural. So there's no way to suppress it. Often people say, oh, so the Stoics tried to suppress emotions. There's no such a thing as suppressing emotions. It's not possible to suppress emotions. But you can manage them. That's the point. That's why even modern psychologists refer to anger management, not anger suppression. The Stoics were the same. Seneca wrote an entire book called On Anger, and as it turns out, he actually goes very specific, very detailed on the nature of anger and how you can deal with anger. And last time I checked the website on the American Psychological Association under anger management, you know, like 80% of the stuff that it's up there is essentially Seneca, updated, of course, to with modern research, but it's about the same kind of insight. So what Epictetus says here is that we should pause when angry. That when we're feeling the first movement of anger, the beginning of anger is this feeling that you might have this physiological reaction, which we know it's due to a release of adrenaline. That you know you feel you're getting upset about something, and if you do that, that is an obvious alarm bell. It's impossible to miss. Now, there's a couple things you could do, right? Most of us might have the temptation of sort of stay with it and say, no, I'm gonna deal with it. I'm gonna sort of suppress it, put it down, and I'm a reasonable person, and so on and so forth. Don't, because it's a losing battle. most of the times the anger will just keep going, and at some point you really get upset and things are going to get worse and worse. The other thing you obviously don't want to do is like, oh yeah, great, I'm feeling angry, so let me go for it and punch somebody on the nose. That's not a thing to do either, right? The thing to do is to disengage, is to create some space between you and the situation. That's what modern psychologists call literally cognitive distancing, right? It can be done, depending on the situation, can be done in a number of ways. If you start counting until 20 or go through the alphabet, engage in some deep breathing, from the diaphragm, because that actually does bring down immediately your physiological reaction. It does actually have an effect of that sort. Or simply walk away, get out, go for a walk if you can, go in another room, go to the bathroom. I read once a Stoic practitioner who is a waiter in New York, and he has a very stressful job. You would think that it's very stressful because the customers tend sometimes to sort of be demanding, and sometimes that's the case, but he said that actually most of the stress comes from fellow waiters and their pressure about doing things or not doing things. And so what he does on a regular basis, when he feels this thing mounting, he just goes to the bathroom for a minute. So he goes there and just disengages from the situation, calms down, and once he's calm, he says, okay, how am I dealing with this particular issue? How am I going to respond to that person? Comment, or how am I going to respond to this particular situation? So that's the notion that you need to be quick on the judgment of your own situation, of self analysis essentially. And then once you calm down, once you actually have this distancing, then you go back to the situation and say, okay, why exactly did I get upset? And it turns out that a lot of the times, there was no particular reason, good reason to get upset. Not always. Sometimes there are good reasons to get upset. But often it's like, oh, that person said something that rubbed me the wrong way. Okay, so what? It's not the end of the world. And maybe he or she did not even mean it. I mean, you don't know. Another instance of this kind of exercise that also comes from Epictetus is a situation where he says, where he reminds his students to say, don't say things like that person drinks too much. Because that's a judgment. You don't know if it is too much for him or not. You have no idea about his background, why he's doing what he's doing, and that sort of stuff. Just say, oh, he drinks above average, right? So try to redescribe the situation in objective terms. And redescribe the situation in objective terms, especially using a second or third person when you're redescribing it, as if you were talking to a friend or if you're talking to somebody else. There is again evidence from modern psychology that actually that does work. It calms you down and it distances you from the situation and it allows you to analyze that situation better, to do exactly what the Stoics told us: live according to nature, use reason instead of an immediate response that it's driven by your emotions, to deal with whatever the problem is. And this may be a small problem, as I said, minor inconvenience that you have, especially when you are in a situation that is by its own nature stressful, like the one we're all experiencing, or if you're dealing with the big things in life, it's always a good thing to slow down, just to play on the famous commercial. I guess the part of what Seneca and Epictetus are saying here is that instead of just do it, you should slow down, think about it, and then decide whether it's actually a good idea to do it or not to do it. So that's pretty much all I wanted to say today. And I don't know, Richard, do we have time for a few questions? How do you want to handle it?
We'll have a little discussion after the program, after yes. Announcements, and then there'll be an opportunity for a little talk back and discussion, which we'll supervise. Well, thank you, Massimo. Thank you so much. My question would be, I'm cognitively distant from my social distancing. Does that mean this is far away?
Well, the problem with social distancing, which actually I heard more than once, people suggesting that we shouldn't call it social distancing. We should call it physical distancing, right? Because you don't want to actually distance yourself from other people socially. You want to distance yourself physically because there is a particular threat to your health and their health. And I think that's actually a good example of how the Stoics think. And often people tell me, oh, but Stoicism is a lot about mind tricks. And my response there is, yeah, well, guess what? Life is about mind tricks. And that's one of them. Rephrase things in a way that actually makes it more helpful. Not social distancing, physical distancing.
Yeah. A number of people have observed that, and I appreciate your saying that too.
So the first one is on the list is David. So let's see, David, unmute. Takes a second usually to unmute. I don't know, or sometimes it takes me more than one effort.
I'm looking.
Okay. Yeah, David should be unmuted now.
Okay. Well, I mean, it's a great talk. I wanted to first, Richard didn't mention announcements, and I did want to make an announcement, which I wanted both the people in the New York Society as well as the Long Island Society to know of our regular monthly discussion, which this Thursday night, which is a meetup, you can sign up for it, is where do we go from here? Challenges and possibilities from coming out of the pandemic. So I bring that to people's attention. You can find it on the meetup, or you can communicate and send register at the Long Island Ethical Society. And it'll be at 7 o'clock on Thursday night. So that was the main thing. I mean, the talk was excellent. I'll leave that for other people to talk about stoicism.
Where do people find that link?
The link is both at Meetup, which you can sign up. It's on web page, or you can send up to the Ethical Society, Long Island. Just send into the office.
Oh, okay.
All right. Either way will be fine. If anybody has trouble with that, they want to contact me, that's fine, and I will be glad to follow up with them. I don't want to take over the discussion. I want people to talk with Massimo. It's a great opportunity to discuss Stoicism. I don't want to interrupt that.
All right. Thank you. Thanks. So then we have, who's got the next hand up? Duffy. Let me see if I can unmute it.
I just did it.
Okay. You just did it. Okay. Great.
Oops. No, back.
Oh, it's back. Yeah. There you go.
Hi, everybody. Right. Good morning. How are you?
Good,
I'm Duffy Spencer. Pleased to meet you. And I am so thrilled to hear your talk. Thank you so much to everyone for organizing both societies, coordinating it this way. I am from the Long Island Society. And I just want to say excellent, of course. And I never thought of myself as a Stoic per se. Yet, you know, I always think of a Stoic as someone who kind of zips it up too much and takes it on the chin and doesn't kind of respond in a feeling sensitive way. And yet everything about Stoicism, all three, not only do I agree with, I live and I teach as a psychotherapist and a human relations teacher. So I'm just interested in the difference between the connotation of the word Stoicism and what you're talking about, because obviously the idea is not emotional suppression, it's emotional management.
Right.
And all of this was conceptualized before we knew we had a three-part brain.
That's right. Yeah.
Bobby came along and said, push your internal pause button before emotional intelligence, Daniel Goldman. You know, don't let your primitive brain be hijacked, your amygdala, all of that. So anyway, some thoughts.
No, thanks. That's an excellent question. And the issue here is, first of all, there is a connection between Stoicism and some brands, at least, of modern cognitive behavioral therapy, for instance, or rational emotive behavioral therapy. All of those actually were inspired directly from Stoic techniques. So there is a connection there. And in terms of where the difference between the word Stoic with a capital S and the word Stoic with a little S, so to speak, this is because, you know, every stereotype has a little bit of a grain of truth. And if you think about it, the stereotype in the modern sense of the English word Stoic has to do with stiff upper lip and suppression of emotions, right? Well, the stiff upper lip stuff comes from the fact that it is, in fact, a Stoic value to endure. If you're faced with a situation that you cannot act on, that you cannot do anything about, then the only two choices are to endure or to complain about it. And according to the Stoics, endurance is better because you don't waste emotional energy and you can actually try to make the best out of the situation. So that turned into the stereotype of the stiff upper lip. In terms of suppression of emotion, so as I just explained, it is in fact a redirection of emotions in a sense, or management of emotions. The Stoics did think that we should try to move away as much as possible from what they thought of as negative and disruptive emotions. Those include anger, hatred, fear, things like that. And by the same time, however, at the same token, we should positively, actively embrace what they call the positive emotions, such as love, joy, and a sense of justice. And so in a sense, Stoicism is actually trying to sort of reorient the emotional spectrum of a human being away from the stuff that is disruptive and not good, not conducive to a good social life, and embracing the stuff that is actually constructive and conducive to a good social life. But if you just focus on the first part, then it may sound like the Stoics are trying to suppress emotions. And that's, I think, where the stereotype comes from. Okay, the next person that I have on my list is Elizabeth. And let me see, can I unmute Elizabeth?
I can do it.
Okay, great. Yeah, thank you. So if you can deal with the muting and unmuting, that'd be great.
Yep, I'll be happy to.
Okay, perfect.
I am trying, but she's not unmuting.
I think I did.
There you go.
Okay, there you go.
Okay. You know, when you talked about what is in our control, and unfortunately a friend passed away last week, and we were trying to think how to have a funeral and a shiva. And somehow, even though I'm technically challenged, they were able to put together, and last Wednesday we had the funeral for a friend in Ohio. Mm-hmm. So I think we were able to refocus on the outcome with this technology. It's just amazing. And in a way, there was a shiva on Friday, and there were participants from England, Australia, from all over the world, which you never would have had at a regular funeral shiva. So if you can look at the positive side, that certainly happened.
Yeah, no, that's exactly right. And that is precisely what the Stoics suggest that we do. And, you know, it isn't a matter of, always look for the positive stuff, because sometimes there is very little positive. You know, somebody dies, there's not much positive back there. All right. But Marcus Aurelius, the Stoic emperor, actually put it this way, that sometimes the obstacle becomes the way, meaning that you have an obstacle, you have a situation that you never encountered before, and it doesn't look like you're going to get through in doing things in the normal way. Well, then it's time to rethink, right? It's time to look at alternatives. Perhaps there is a way in which you can do something close to what you wanted to do, but by other means. Yes, you just mentioned this. The one that you mentioned is a perfect example. Another one is these Stoa Nova events that I used to do physically for ethical culture. I'm still doing them. In fact, I'm doing more now. They used to be only once a month. Now they're kind of almost weekly. And now they're on Zoom, of course. And so the result is that they're not only open to ethical culture members or to people who live in New York. Yesterday, I did one with more than 100 people. And there were people from Australia, from Japan, from the UK. And so those are people that obviously normally wouldn't be able to make it to New York to come to these kind of meetings. And the technology, the situation, first the problem, and then the technology to solve that problem, to get around that problem, made it possible. So, right, the basic notion here is not to focus on the stuff that you cannot do. So if you start saying, your friend dies, and you say, oh, well, I can't go there physically, I cannot hug people, I cannot do this. Well, all of that is true, but it's not very helpful. It's just going to make you feel bad. And you already lost a friend, so you already feel bad, presumably. So now you're feeling even worse because you're focusing your attention on all the stuff that you cannot do. I have an example in my family. For instance, my sister recently has been starting posting on social media all these pictures of things that she used to do, last year. And she keeps saying, I wish I could do that. I wish I could do that. And at some point I said, Fabiana, you need to stop this because this is not good for you. What you need to do is to focus on what you can do. You're living your mother, you're taking care of her. You do have friends who live nearby. You can talk to me across the ocean because of these amazing technologies. So focus on the things that you can do, as opposed to sort of regretting the things you can't do, because you're taking control of things, and human beings feel much better if we have some sense of agency about things. So I think this, thank you for the example. That's a great example of how to deal with it, with this kind of situation, stoically, so to speak. John is next. John Sefto.
Yes. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Hi.
And I can even see you.
Oh, yes. Hi. Thank you so much for the talk and for your work. Your book was my entryway into Stoicism, and I've been closely following your work since then. So thank you. So my question is actually in reference to an article that you wrote on your blog about, and you provided two tables of Stoic positive emotions and negative emotions. And yes. I just get tripped up thinking about it sometimes because you say, so in the tables of negative emotions, for instance, you say, I forgot what the word was, but like an impulse towards something, an impulse away for something bad that is not actually bad and I know you provided some actual examples in the article, but like I found that very helpful, but I feel like I lose the concept a lot. I know I'm probably not articulating it that well, but yeah. I'm sure that this group would really appreciate the, if you maybe talk about those tables a little bit, and if you could provide some examples to help me better understand them.
Yeah, that's actually a great question. And you're right. I think people might be, derive benefits from talking a little bit more about that. As I said, this goes back to the Stoic management of emotions. And I think that the simple way to understand actually what the Stoics were after is they thought that there are some emotions that are in a sense in accordance with reason and some emotions that try to overtake reason. Now, before I go on and give you any examples or any additional information, let me remind people of one important thing. The Stoics thought that the mind is one thing. It's not like they thought that there is a separate compartment for the emotions and a separate compartment for reason and so on and so forth. And it turns out modern neuroanatomy pretty much supports that view. It is true that the brain does have different areas that are primarily involved either in emotional response. For instance, the amygdala is involved in emotional responses. That's what triggers your adrenaline rush, for instance, if in situations of fear and things like that, or anger. And it's also true that the frontoparietal lobes of the brain are involved in sort of rational decision-making, that sort of stuff. So anatomically, there are these sub-portions of the brain, but modern neuroanatomy also shows very clearly that these are massively interconnected. There are like hundreds of millions of neurons, neural fibers that go back and forth, the amygdala and the frontoparietal lobes, which means that you cannot really separate the two functions, okay? Your emotions and your ability to reason about stuff, they're all one bundle. And the Stoics had this intuition, obviously they knew nothing about neuroanatomy, but they had this intuition that unlike Plato, who was talking about separate compartments, and he said that reason ought to be in charge of the other compartments. You know, it has to be like, he had this famous metaphor of the charioteer, where you imagine a chariot with two horses, and the two horses are your unwieldy emotions, and the charioteer is the guy in charge, is reason. So reason needs to be suppressing, basically controlling the emotions in some way or another. Otherwise, the chariot is going to go, off the road. The Stoics are nothing like that. They said, no. That's too simplistic of a thing. The human mind is one unified thing, and everything happens at the same time. And so you just need to balance things out and to manage. You can't suppress things. You can't control things. So as I said, they literally define the positive emotions as emotional responses that are, as they put it, in accordance with reason. So to be loving to somebody else, to another human being, is in accordance with reason, meaning that it is a good thing to do. If you thought about it, you said, yeah, of course I should be loving. Developing a sense of justice, which they interestingly understood as an emotion, not just as a cognitive decision, right? But it's an emotion, like when you feel that something is wrong and you want to do something about it, that is an emotional response. And they thought that emotional response is also in accordance with reason, because reason tells you that, of course, you should be countering injustice, and of course you should be work for a more just world. But then there is also emotions that are, in a sense, try to take over in the wrong direction. Those are the emotions that are contrary to reason. And the, as I said earlier, the classic example is anger. But also desiring things that are not appropriate for you to desire. And that, so that gets to your specific question. Like, for instance, let's take love. Well, love is also connected in human beings. If we're talking about sexual love, it's connected with lust, right? The two are kind of coming in a bundle. And the issue, according to the Stoics, is that love toward the person that you've committed to, toward your wife or husband or partner, whatever it is, that is in accordance with reason. But lust for the first person of the appropriate sex that walks down the street because you find her or him attractive, that is not in accordance with reason. Why is it not in accordance with reason? Because, of course, if you act on it, that's going to undermine the good that you have in life. You're going to be betraying the trust that other people have in you, and so on and so forth. So every time that we deal with an emotional response of one way or another, the first question that the Stoic asks himself is, well, is this emotional response in accordance with reason or not? If it is in accordance with reason, I'm going to foster it. I'm going to cultivate it. If it is in disagreement with reason, if it goes against reason, then I need to deal with it. I need to think, well, why am I thinking this? And how am I going to act properly about this? So I hope that that makes some sense. Next we have Rosa. Rosa, are you there?
Yeah, I'm not sure how I'm doing.
You're doing good. Yeah, okay. I can hear you.
First of all, thank you so much. Grazie mille for your splendid presentation.
Prego.
Really enlightening, and I greatly appreciate it. And so I have a question. You know, growing up in Italy, we hear the word pazienza, patience, a lot.
Right.
So is there a difference between the concept of being patient and being stoic? Is there any way you can, you know, explore a little bit on the difference, if there is a difference? Thank you.
No, that's a great question. Yeah, thank you. Well, definitely patience is a Stoic virtue. The Stoics did try to develop, that doesn't mean that if you're a patient person, you're necessarily a Stoic, obviously. But if you're trying to practice Stoic philosophy, definitely patience is one of the minor virtues. The Stoics had recognized four fundamental cardinal virtues, and those are practical wisdom, courage, justice, and temperance. But one of the sub virtues under temperance usually is patience. You want to be patient with people. In fact, Marcus Aurelius says all the time to himself, because he wrote the Meditations by Marcus Aurelius was actually his personal philosophical diary. So he was writing to himself, right? And he was reminding himself constantly. It's like, you know, you have basically two, whenever somebody disagrees with you, and remember this was the emperor, right? So he literally had power of life and death over people. If you disagree with the emperor, you could lose your head. But he reminds himself, like, no, that's not a good way to deal with other people. There's only two things you can do when people disagree with you, or when people insult you, or when people say something that is stupid or whatever. The first one is, your first duty is to teach them, is to correct them, if you can. Right? Actually, he says, the very first is to listen to what they're saying, because it may very well be that sometimes something is annoying to you, but it's actually correct, right? In which case, you need to thank them. No matter how annoying the thing was, you know, somebody criticizes you, but the criticism actually hits the mark. You should train yourself to say, well, thank you. That's, you're right on that one, right? That should be the first response. The second response, assuming that you actually are instead comfortable with the notion that, no, actually they're not getting it right. I have the better, reasoning or facts or on my side or whatever it is, then you need to teach them. Then you need to educate. Because, why? Because they're fellow human beings. And we're all in this together. The Stoics were cosmopolitan. They believed that we should treat every other human being on earth, no matter where he or she is from, or no matter what it is. Seneca says, you call that person a slave, but he's actually a person. He's exactly like you. And he has the same capability to suffer or to think that you do, which for the time was an incredible statement to make. So Michael says, you know, you should teach people, you should try to correct people. And if that fails as well, then nature endowed you with the virtue of patience. You just endure. It's like, you know what? Okay, I tried. I did my best. And if I failed, that's okay. It may be that I wasn't clear enough. It may be that I was not convincing enough. Or it may be that this person is just not in a position where he can listen right at this moment. So what am I going to do? Punch him on the nose or, you know, cut off his head? No. You're just going to say, all right, then end of the discussion. We're fine. You don't get upset. You don't start cursing him and all that sort of stuff. So cultivating patience is a very important aspect of Stoic practice. Of course, it's, as you probably know, it's far from easy because there's all sorts of situations where we get upset and we lose control. And that's okay because the Stoics are very, Stoicism is very self, both other forgiving and self-forgiving philosophy. So if you slip back, if you say, if you lose it, you get upset at some point, you say, well, that's okay. You try your best. Let's disengage from this situation. Let me learn from the lesson and maybe I'll do better the next time. But absolutely, patience is necessary. Patience is necessary in order to cultivate a good social life because, you know, Jean-Paul Sartre, who was not a Stoic philosopher, he was an existentialist, famously said that hell is other people, right? But he also immediately said, and there's nothing you can do about it. I mean, you have to deal with other people because that is exactly what the human condition is. It's like, you know, you don't get to choose how other people behave. You don't control other people's reactions. You only can barely control your own. And so that's where you should focus.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. So next we have, let's see, Lindobrin is the screen name.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. Thank you.
Okay, you hear me. Wonderful talk. I'm thinking about your handbook, and Is it designed for people to read and think about, or would it work for a group discussion, each chapter?
It would definitely work for a group discussion. In fact, it's really not designed to read. It's designed to use it as for practice.
For practice as a group?
Either individually or as a group, yes. Okay. Stoic practice actually is better in a group, as it turns out, because people can check on each other progress. Right. So the way Greg and I suggest to do this is to pick an exercise a week, let's say, or an exercise a month, depending on what your time frame is. And then to read together maybe the exercise itself, start talking about how to do it, and then go home and actually do it for a week or a month or whatever it is, and then come back as a group and say, so how did you do? Or how did that work? What kind of challenges did you encounter? Greg and I set up a Facebook page that is devoted exclusively as a support group for people who are actually going through the book. And it's very useful because people do post questions like, well, I'm in, you know, week three and I'm stuck because I can't, you know, get this exercise done properly. And so either Greg or I or somebody else, you know, people in the group will actually chime in and help out. The other thing is if you want to do that, then I may suggest is the book has 52 exercises, which is a lot. It's designed for if you want to do a whole year of a curriculum. But there is a shortcut. If you read the introduction, at the end of the introduction, we actually highlight 9 exercises, 3 for each one of the 3 disciplines of Epictetus, 3 for the discipline of desire, 3 for the discipline of action, and 3 for the discipline of assent. And we say, you know, if you're not sure that you want to commit to that much energy, that much time to this kind of thing, because you are, well, busy and all that, then start with those. Do those 9 exercises. That's a fairly small commitment and see how that works out. And then if you feel that that's useful, then go ahead and explore some of the others. The other thing is the book doesn't have to be read cover to cover because the exercises are pretty much independent of each other. What I would suggest is, however, to sample exercises from each one of the 3 sections. So don't do just 1 section and then ignore the other 2. Because each section is connected to one of the 3 disciplines of Epictetus. And so they need to be practiced, all 3 of them. And in fact, if somebody actually goes through the exercises, even if you want to do all of them, at the end of each exercise, each chapter, we actually provide a little checkbox. And so that somebody can say, well, this was actually useful to me or not. Because some of the exercises might not, you know, speak to people or might not work particularly well for somebody. And at the end of the day, If you keep checking the boxes, you will have your own personalized Stoic curriculum. You have your own personalized set of exercises and then you can go back over and over. When I did it, for instance, at the end of the year, I find myself with 9 exercises that work for me. Mm-hmm. And those are the ones that I keep doing over and over because they just are helpful as far as I'm concerned.
And what's the best way for us to get the book so that you make the most profit?
Try not to get it on Amazon. And that's not about my profit. It's about Amazon being a monster with its own employees. So there is a number of independent bookstores, or you can go straight to the publisher's website. The publisher is called The Experiment.
The Experiment?
Yes. It's the smallest publisher in New York, and you can go straight to their website. Or there is a website called indiebound.com, which is about independent bookstores. Mm. And so they will send you the book by involving one of the closest independent bookstore to where you are.
Thank you.
Thank you, absolutely. And the next question, Ginger.
Hi, good morning.
Hi.
Good afternoon. I wanted to thank you in terms of your very intellectually stimulating discussion talk this morning. It just made so many thoughts come to mind that I can't, you know, my mind is racing, especially with so many interesting questions. So I don't know if I have a question, but it brings to mind a lot of gender differences that we have in our society. And are you familiar with the Four Agreements?
No, the around you. Okay. Four Agreements, yeah.
It's a wonderful little book. A philosophy written by Don Miguel Ruiz. Mm-hmm. And he talks basically about the four agreements that we have to make for ourselves. Mm. Right? Because when we are born, we're born into a society that already has made agreements that it kind of pushes on us as we grow up.
Right.
So there's a society. And what I think is that so many of us, when you talk about the emotional and the Stoic side, there's women who are suppressed and men who are suppressed or repressed. So one enforces women, girls, to smile, and it's okay for them to cry, it's okay for them to express their feelings, but the male part of our society is played down that emotional expression
right.
You know, don't cry, hold back, you know,
right.
don't talk, they don't express their emotions easily. So I somehow seem this kind of connected with the discussion this morning.
Well, so as I said earlier, yeah, the Stoics are definitely not about suppressing emotions. In fact, you should do whatever it is that works for you in a sense, right? And certainly nobody should tell you what to do or what not to do. Because one of the fundamental Stoics principles is it's sometimes referred to as the Stoic fork. And it's this notion that we talked about earlier from Epictetus, that there are two categories of things or actions, those that are up to you and those that are not up to you. And the basic notion is that other people's opinions, judgments, and actions are not up to you. They're up to them, right? They're a reflection of their own character, they're a reflection of their own decision-making, their own judgment, and so on and so forth. And so you really shouldn't going around telling people, do this or do that. You might make suggestions if you think that they are in other people's interests, obviously. We live in a society, so if we think that somebody's engaging in, self-destructive kind of behavior, you do want to intervene. You do want to say, hey, you know, this is not the best thing to do for you. But ultimately, it is that person's judgment that counts, not yours. You should be focused. The Stoic practitioner tends to focus on their own judgments. And so, let's say when it comes down to, you know, should I speak up or should I not, or should I cry or should I not, should I do this or that, then the only person that can give an answer to that question is yourself. Like, well, why am I doing this? Why do I want to do this, or why do I not want to do this? It's a lot about critical self-reflection. So there are a lot of habits that we inherit. You said that we're born with certain, you know, features in a certain society. So we kind of take on board a number of things. including a lot of values, right? So a lot of our values come from the fact that we grow up in a certain environment, that we have certain parents, that we have certain teachers, certain peers, and so on and so forth. And the Stoics would say, well, all of those were given to you from the outside. But the hallmark of a mature person is, at least from time to time, to stop and say, yeah, but are these values really acceptable to me? Are these actually really good for me? Like, for instance, we live, as you know, in a highly consumeristic society, right? So we're told that in order to be happy, we have to keep buying things. One of the phrases that I found so strange and amusing shortly after I moved from Italy to the United States is the concept of retail therapy. It's this notion that in order to feel better about yourself, go shopping, right? It's like, wait, what? Hold on. Clearly there is an agenda here. Somebody has an agenda about this sort of stuff, right? So the Stoic would say, from time to time, at least, you have to step back and think about that sort of stuff that you take for granted. And in fact, it's other people's opinions. It's the advertiser's opinion that you should do that, or it's the advertiser's wish that you should do that. But is it really something that works for you? Is it really something, do you want to be the kind of person that, in order to feel better, goes out shopping, or in this case, during a pandemic, stays inside and goes online shopping? Is it really a good thing for you? So there is a lot of, Stoicism really is a lot about self-reflecting and reevaluating your own judgments, your own values, your own conclusions about things constantly throughout your life, because it's possible that you will change your mind and you keep reflecting on these things and you'll change your mind. I mean, you might change your endorsed values. You might change the way you think about things because, in fact, you're thinking about it as opposed to just passively accepting whatever somebody else has told you or is trying to push on you. So that's one way to think about it.
Thank you.
Next, we got David.
Oh, this David. Okay, yeah, thanks.
Sorry, David Bass. Yeah.
Great discussion, everyone. Thanks. Grazie, Massimo. It's the only Italian I know.
It's good enough.
So, yeah, I'm really just intrigued with the whole question of control. I mean, where does our control over circumstances begin and stop? I mean, you know, the phrase comes to mind, think globally, act locally. And that's mm-hmm. kind of a clear partition too, but partly because we do have this incredible communication, media technology, we're all aware of what's happening throughout the globe almost instantly. And
right.
One instance, Saudi Arabia bombs a Yemeni hospital or bus with children using American bombs. I don't want to make this like totally grim, but I really get outraged. I mean, really severely angry over this, but I feel powerless. I can write my senators, Gillibrand and Schumer, Congressman Espaillat, and say, let's stop giving the Saudi, the House of Saud, bombs to do this with. But what are we doing with knowledge of that sort and where we feel essentially very limited in power?
Yeah, that is an excellent question. I'm going to tell you right up front, you might not like the answer, but this is the best answer I'm going to be able to give you. So, especially with Greg, with my friend Mike Water, Greg Lopez, we've actually thought of a lot about this kind of stuff because we're both in the same situation, right? So we look at news, it's like, oh crap, again, this is other stuff. And you get upset, and that's natural, it's human. In fact, it's a good thing that you get upset, because if you didn't get upset at the notion that your tax dollars are being used to bomb people on the other side of the world, then I would think there's something wrong with you. However, we both thought about it very carefully from a Stoic perspective in terms of agency, right? I don't really like the word control. And unfortunately, this notion that I've just been talking about, which I've been referring to as things that are up to you or not up to you, or things that are the Stoic fork, sometimes is referred to as the dichotomy of control. And unfortunately, control is an unfortunate word because it's too stark. We don't really control pretty much anything. it's yeah. That's why I like better the notion of where is your agency, where do you maximize your agency, right?
Right.
Right. So the distinction here is between maximizing agency and dispersing your agency over things that are not actually very effective. So what Greg and I have come up with is two things. First of all, we have gone on a media diet. We consume far less news than before. The suggestion is not to shut everything down completely, because you do want to, as a citizen of the world, you want to be informed about what's going on in the world. I mean, that's perfectly reasonable. But I used to be fairly described as what people refer to as a news junkie. You know, lots of NPR, New York Times, et cetera, et cetera. And BBC, and then Italian news on top of that, you know, that sort of stuff. That is not useful. And the reason it's not useful is because a lot of those news are non-actionable. There's nothing you can do about it. And they only make you upset. They really get at you and they grind you down. Because if you do it day by day by day over a period of years, they really will grind you down. So the first piece of advice is to go on a news diet. Again, not on a complete diet. You know, just treat it as a diet. You wouldn't go on a complete fasting for you know, the rest of your life, because you're gonna starve. So yes. Don't do that. But a diet, yes. So take things a little bit, you know, use temperance. Pick a few sources and spend a few minutes a day to catch up with the big picture, but not too much, because it becomes upsetting. And more importantly, it's the kind of upset that you cannot actually turn into action.
Yeah.
What you can do, on the other hand, you can act locally, as you were saying. Certainly calling Gildebrand and Schumer and all that sort of stuff, it's certainly something to do. But even that is actually not local enough. What Greg in particular has been doing, and he's been very effective, is actually to call his local representative, really local at the level of county or, you know, state or not even the federal level, and calling them over and over repeatedly and writing letters locally and donating money locally. And he found out, interestingly, as you might expect, that local politicians are far more sensitive to this kind of stuff. Because, you know, Schumer has to, in order to get reelected, or Gillibrand, in order to get reelected, they need millions. And they're not going to be paying much attention. I know, because I've actually talked to their offices, you know, yeah, multiple times. They're just not going to pay attention to you, because you're small potatoes from their perspective. But if you talk to your county representative or to your state representative or to, you know, at a more local level, they will listen, because, as it turns out, you know, your vote really does make a difference. Your effort really does make a difference. They do need the little money you're going to be able to give them, or they do need your specific vote, because they might lose or win the next election by a handful of votes. And so yours is going to make a difference, especially if it is a repetitive effort, a constant, you know, so, okay, let me go back and then follow up. Hey, did anything happen on this thing? Greg was actually able to get some legislation passed locally by this, in this manner, because he focused his energy where his agency was maximized.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm sure that the objection to this is, yeah, but that's not going to solve the problem of Saudi Arabians bombing, you know, the other side of the world. True, but if that problem is entirely outside of your control, all you can do is what you already did: talk to the senators, and maybe, you know, make or withdraw financial support for those people. That's it. Other than that, you don't have a lot that you can possibly do about it. And therefore, the notion is that happiness, in part, depends, as we were saying earlier, on agency, on the exercise of agency. Human beings tend to be happy, content with their lives when they can exercise agency. Otherwise, we get frustrated. We get angry for no reason. So that would be my advice, this dual approach, a little bit of a diet, you know, media diet, and more focus on the local aspect. It may be initially, it may feel like kind of cop out or like giving up, but in fact, over time, you will see results that you won't see otherwise.
Mm. Thank you, Massimo.
Yeah, absolutely. Next we have John. John, are you there?
Yeah.
Hi. Actually, I can't hear you. All of a sudden, I could hear you for a second, and then not anymore.
What's his name?
There, John, yeah. Just hold tight.
Here we go.
Okay, great.
Hi, I asked a question before, but I guess I got back online. And that was really a great question, really helpful response about media diet. So, as over the past 5 months or so, as I've been doing more reading on Stoicism, I've noticed it appears to have become really popular. And I heard it described by Tim Ferriss as like an operating system to help one become like more productive. So I felt like it was like kind of like morally dubious. I've heard it like it's used by soldiers. And so I guess I'm curious about like your take on how Stoicism is being used as a way to like make us better workers or more productive or in some cases like better soldiers or things like that.
Right. No, that's an excellent question. I actually written a trio of essays about this, about Stoicism and Silicon Valley and making money and entrepreneurship, about what I call broicism, that is Stoicism and brothers, and as in, you know, men's rights kind of stuff. And then the third one is about Stoicism and the military. And you are absolutely right. I suppose that that's the price to pay for success. Once the philosophy gets on the mainstream, as Stoicism has had over the last several years, then of course all sorts of spin-offs and sort of dubious applications are going to come up. I mean, Christianity is not itself immune from it, right? The so-called prosperity gospel is an incredible aberration of Christianity, and yet it's out there. And the same goes for Buddhism, for instance, which is being used to sell all sorts of things to people. I think that a useful way to approach that issue is that Stoicism really comes in two components, just like pretty much any philosophy of life or religion. There is the theory, there is the philosophy itself, and then there is the practice, right? The exercises. Think about Buddhism, for instance. There is the theory, there is the notion that the problem with humanity is the problem of suffering, and the problem of suffering is caused by too much ego, right? That's sort of the theory. And then there is the practice. The practices include things like meditation. And some kind of meditation actually aims at deflating the ego, precisely because an uninflated ego is diagnosed by Buddhists as to be a major problem, you know, causing suffering in the world. However, you can use the meditation techniques just to calm down, or to deal with pain, or to relax, or, you know, to do all sorts of stuff. That doesn't mean you're a Buddhist, right? You're using meditation, you're using a technique to achieve a particular specific goal, but that doesn't make you a Buddhist, because unless you believe that your ego needs to be deflated and the suffering is a major problem in the world that you need to do something about, then you're not a Buddhist. Similarly, with another very interesting philosophy that comes with a large set of practical techniques, and that's yoga. Most of us think of yoga as just, you know, what you do in the gym to, you know, become more flexible and, you know, to exercise and so on and so forth. But yoga, it's actually a philosophy which is very old. It predates Buddhism. And most of us don't hear about the philosophy. But so just because you practice yoga in, you know, at the gym, that doesn't mean you're a yogi, actually. It doesn't mean that you are actually somebody who endorses the philosophy. So the same exact thing goes for Stoicism. Stoic techniques work, and we have, you know, evidence that they do. That's, I mentioned earlier that cognitive behavioral therapy and rational emotive behavior therapy were originally inspired by Stoic techniques, particularly by the writings of Marcus Aurelius and Seneca. And people have done research on these things, and they do work, right? So for instance, keeping a philosophical diary, keeping a diary of your of things that are happening that are, where you reacted badly or not, or you know, in a good way, keeping a diary and reflecting on that diary, it's helpful. There is very good empirical evidence that that is the case, but you don't need to be a Stoic in order to keep a diary, obviously. To be a Stoic means that you buy in the premise of the philosophy, which is what I started my talk today with. And the two premises are: your goal in life should be to become the best human being you can. Morally the best human being, not the best entrepreneur or the most rich or the most famous, but the best ethical, the most ethical person you can. That's the goal of life according to a Stoic. And two, that the way you do that is by applying reason to improve social problems, right? To improve social situation. If you're doing that, if you're doing those two things, if those are really your goals, then you definitely are a Stoic. Whether you practice specific techniques or not, then it becomes kind of incidental. And so that's the way I think about it. I do have problems with those aspects of Stoicism. In fact, Tim Ferriss, I think, it's somewhat problematic from that perspective, because he does literally sell the philosophy as you know, a set of techniques to become, you know, to make it and become famous and rich. But Seneca would have told you right there that if your goal in life is to become rich and famous, then you're just doing it wrong from the get-go. That there's nothing wrong, by the way, in Stoicism, or according to the Stoics, there's nothing wrong with wealth or fame. Those are as they call it, preferred indifference. Right? So those things that if you have them, great, enjoy them. That's okay. You know, having money, it's a good thing, and you know, having influence on other people is a good thing, so long as you use it correctly, and so long as you did not acquire them in unethical ways. So there is no problem in Stoicism about wealth per se or about fame per se, but those are never the goals. Those are just incidentals. Those are things that, oh, if you have them, good. But if you don't have them, the way Seneca puts it is very clear. Those things do not make you either a better person or a worse person. They're just morally neutral. What is important, in fact, it's the other way around, is how you're going to deal with those things. If you are famous, what are you going to do with your fame? Are you going to use it to influence people for the best, or are you going to actually use it to, you know, enrich yourself and maximize, you know, suffering in others? That's the thing. Okay, is it David? David Sprinson?
Yeah. Can I?
Yes, go ahead.
Oh, good. Your comment before stimulated my reflections about the history of Stoicism and its increasing popularity now. I was wondering what you would say about one who suggests that the popularity of Stoicism in some way is related to or responds to an increasing sense of social impotence, that it developed in the classical world as the destruction of the city-state was taken over by empires and people then were drawn within themselves. And the problem in some sense in America now, one of the real emotional tragedies that in some sense we're all experiencing is the sense that we believed we're in a democracy in which human beings could actively participate in the determination of our politics, and increasingly now have a sense that it's out of our control. And right. I thought your answer, Rich, I thought responded directly to that correctly. But it does, and it does, I think it suggests that in fact Stoicism is historically has been and can work very well and is popular in the sense of a kind of refuge philosophy, that when you feel that the world is really out of your control, and how do you find your life in such a world?
No, that's an excellent question. I would answer in a couple of ways. First of all, historically, that's probably true. Plenty of people have commented, historians have commented that not just Stoicism, but a number of other Hellenistic philosophies like Epicureanism, Aristotelianism, and so on and so forth. They all come up pretty much at the same time. And the Hellenistic period was, in fact, marked by a lot of turmoil. That period goes from the death of Alexander the Great and therefore the collapse of the Macedonian Empire to the beginning of the Roman Empire, right? So those were times where things were happening completely outside of the control of people, major changes, political, social, and so on and so forth. And so it makes sense that those philosophies that focus on what you can do and on self improvement and self reliance, they would become popular at that particular point in time. The same is actually true also for other philosophies and religions. People have made the argument that a very similar situation was true for the origin of Buddhism about 200 years earlier in India, because India was also going through a series of, you know, turmoil, social and political. And at the same time as Buddhism was coming up in India, Confucianism in China was also going through the same kind of popularity, because presumably the same kind of reasons. And I think you're absolutely right that the reason that Stoicism came back, and Stoicism is not the only one, Buddhism has been very popular over the last several decades in the West. And I think it's for the same reason. I mean, after all, the last century was the first one when we had two, not one, but two world wars. It's the first time in history where we literally are capable of destroying our own planet, either by way of climate change or by way of nuclear Armageddon, you know, pick your poison. It is true that we've been going through major political, social, economic upheavals. So it makes perfect sense to me that people would go back to these kind of, in particularly in a time where mainstream religions are not as appealing as they used to be, right? The number of so-called nuns, meaning people that don't think of themselves as religious in the traditional sense, has gone up significantly in Europe, and it is, even in the United States, it's up to about 20% or so. And those are not all atheists. Those are not all, and even atheists, they still need some kind of framework to operate in life. So I would agree with all of that. That said, I would add one caveat, which is, I think that Stoicism or Buddhism or these other philosophies work, their value is particularly obvious in times of crisis. But they actually are everyday kinds of philosophies, because if you think about it, none of us goes through life without setbacks or tragedy. At the very least, we're gonna lose some of our loved ones, right? We're gonna lose our parents, we're gonna lose some friends or some things like that. Stuff happens. And then of course we have to face our own mortality at some point. So nobody's life, no matter how lucky you are, how wealthy and so on and so forth, is without setbacks or without tragedy. And Stoicism or Buddhism or similar philosophies prepare you to deal with that sort of situation. It's just that once all of a sudden you're in the middle of a pandemic and you say, oh my gosh, this is really where it comes to the front, because the issue is obvious, it's on the nose, and it's everybody that gets involved in it. But I have to say, having practiced Stoicism for the last 5 or 6 years now, this definitely prepared me for this kind of stuff. It now comes, certain kinds of responses come to me now as a second nature. Like for instance, the Stoic fork that I mentioned earlier, immediately, as soon as we have a problem, or my wife and I have a problem or run into some kind of issue, the immediate thought, now it's automatic. It didn't used to be automatic, but now it's automatic. It's like, okay, what things are up to us and what things are not up to us here. And it can go from the big things like an actual tragedy to the small ones. Like a couple of weeks ago, our refrigerator stopped working. Oh crap, in the middle of a pandemic, that's not a good thing. We can't, not now what? And the thought was not, we didn't sort of get upset and start to say, oh gosh, not only there is a pandemic, not only we can't go, but now there's also, the immediate thought was, okay, so what can we do here? And the first thought was, well, today's grocery shopping is gonna lean toward dry food and canned food because we don't know where we can store stuff. That was number one. Number two, let's call the landlady and see what can be done. Well, it turns out that big appliances cannot be delivered to our building during the pandemic. So that's out of the thing. But our landlady said, yeah, but as it turns out, I can deliver to you small appliances. So she sent us a dorm fridge. And the dorm fridge is good enough. We've solved the problem. So our diet is shifted a little bit more toward frozen stuff and dry stuff. But we still have some fresh things that we put in the little refrigerator. And that was it, end of story. No drama. No, oh my gosh, what's going on, that sort of stuff. And that came in part with practice, right? With the fact that you repeat to yourself every day, over and over, every time you encounter a situation or a setback, the first thing you say is like, okay, what is it I can actually do here? Where is my locus of action? And it's like learning to drive a car. Initially, you had to actually pay conscious attention to everything. Where's the shift and there's the brake and all that. But eventually, it becomes second nature. You don't have to think about this stuff. It comes back to you immediately under whatever situation you find yourself because you got used to it. It's like it becomes second nature. All right. It looks like we are out of questions. I think. Thank you, everybody.
Wait a minute. I think.
There's one more.
One more, Linda?
Yeah.
Go ahead, go for it.
Hi, Massimo, thank you very much. This has been wonderful. I just wanted to say that as a personal philosophy, I think that, everything you've said about Stoicism is something that I can understand and I can really identify with.
Right.
But I still feel like as a social philosophy, unless every human being in the world participated, it's like walking away from reality in the sense of, I was thinking of, first I was thinking of myself as a woman and how there are so many issues in society, that put women down, that oppress women. But right. more so, I was thinking of the African-American population, you know, putting it in a domestic, in the United States, the framework of the right. United States. And, you know, this whole business of if someone says something to you and you listen and then you correct them or, you know, or you accept it if it's something that's true about you, and then you basically walk away or accept mm-hmm. or endure.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, I can't put myself in the place of someone who has experienced oppression throughout their lives, even in right. this day and age, you know, never mind slavery and Jim Crow.
Right.
So how does Stoicism apply to something like that?
No, that is a great question. And the first part of the response is that you shouldn't try to put yourself in somebody else's shoes, because you can't, you cannot, you don't have those same kind of experiences. So when, in fact, Epictetus is very clear in the Enchiridion, he says, when somebody else needs help of a particular kind or whatever, they expect something from you, including, you know, a display of emotional reactions or whatever it is, you should do it, because it's about them, not about you. So the Stoic advice is that you, when somebody insults you, you should remind yourself that, you know, an insult is just somebody opening his mouth and moving air, and it doesn't touch me. But that's about you. So you should be train yourself to do that and to ignore the insult and just walk away, because that's, according to Stoic philosophy, it's the best way to do. But if your friend is being insulted, or if somebody else is being insulted or ill-treated or, you know, unjustly treated, no, you should definitely intervene. I mean, one of the four cardinal virtues is justice. And the Stoics have it at the forefront. It is one of the fundamental ways in which you act toward other people. You should never assume that other people are going to react as a Stoic should. It's only about you. This is about your own behavior. But as far as other people are concerned, if they need help of whatever kind, you are in fact duty-bound, according to the Stoics, to help them. The Stoics talked about women. The Zeno, the founder of Stoic philosophy, actually said that women and men have the same intellectual capacities and they should be treated the same way. And then earlier I mentioned slavery. Seneca says, you know, what you call a slave is a human being. And Zeno says explicitly, slavery is evil. For the time, this was unbelievable. So it was really incredible kind of way of putting things, because you have to remember that Roman society was based on slavery, right? Economically. So, and also in terms of society, there is the additional very important aspect of Stoicism that doesn't get talked about enough in my mind, and that's the cosmopolitanism, right? So the Stoics say, do like Socrates did, never say I'm from Athens or Corinth or whatever, say that I'm a citizen of the world. And they took that very seriously. For them, they meant that you have a duty to every other single human being in the world. Whether you can actually, you know, carry out that duty depends on your circumstances. You're gonna help whoever you can, nearby or far away, depending on your reach, your technology, you know, your financial situation, et cetera, et cetera. But for the Stoics, we actually have a duty to help human beings, because we're all in this together. This is we're on the same boat, and we are tightly interconnected with every other being on earth, not just human beings actually, but particularly with other human beings. So there is actually very much of a social component. There is modern writings by some of my colleagues about Stoicism and environmentalism, about Stoicism and human rights, and things of that sort. So it is actually a very much a social philosophy, but it is a social philosophy, you're right, in a sense, where the social begins with you. You don't start by telling other people what to do. You start by telling yourself, what is the best thing that I can do in order to be making things better, right? But there's also, you know, in the history of Stoicism, there are some really fairly amazing situations that tell you just how much the Stoics thought they ought to be involved. If you actually check it out on Wikipedia, there is an article called The Stoic Opposition. And the Stoic opposition was a number of Stoic philosophers and senators, Roman senators, who opposed vocally the tyranny, what they saw as the tyranny of three emperors, Nero, Vespasian, and Domitian. As a result, several of them were killed, as you might imagine, and some of them were sent into exile. Epictetus was one of them. Epictetus was sent into exile. Seneca was another one. He was killed. So was Lucan, who was Seneca's nephew, and he was a famous poet. He was killed because he was a member of a conspiracy against Nero. So episodes like that, like this, and there are several others, but episodes like the Stoic opposition tell you that Stoics are actually very much into doing the right thing at a social level, however they can, right? The focus is always on what you can actually do in terms of your agency and not sort of this, any kind of general, concept of, well, shouldn't things work this way? Well, maybe they should, maybe they shouldn't. But the thing is, what can you actually do? And even Marcus Aurelius, who was of course the emperor, right? So he had a significant amount of power, obviously, but he wasn't omniscient and he was not all powerful either, because there were certain things that he couldn't have done, even if he wanted, because he was well aware that emperors that became unpopular were done with, right? You know, that several of these, of the previous emperors were eliminated sometimes by their own bodyguard. So he was very aware of this thing. But there's a wonderful bit in the meditation where he says, don't wait for Plato's Republic to be enacted on Earth. Just do whatever you can, however little, right now, because it matters. Right? And the phrase, don't wait for Plato's Republic, was the ancient version of don't wait for utopia. Don't wait for things, because that Plato's Republic is one of the main, the ancient versions of utopia. Don't wait for things to just be perfect and for, heaven on earth to arrive, because that's not going to happen. And I love that phrasing of do whatever you can, however little, because it matters, right? Yeah. It does matter, right? So that's my response. So you're right that's often the perception of Stoicism, that it's mostly about, it's an internal philosophy, it's a personal philosophy, and to some extent that is true. But there is in fact a large and important and often underappreciated social component to it.
Thank you.
Yeah. And then we got another one, Barbara, I think.
I can't see because something happened to my view, but I just was enjoying your talk. And could you please give us the name for that handbook the gentleman mentioned that you could go through?
So the book that I co-wrote with Greg Lopez is called The Handbook for New Stoics, A Handbook for New Stoics. And it's published by The Experiment. You can find it in bookstores online or offline. The writings that I quoted today, on the other hand, they come from Epictetus, and the book there is called The Enchiridion. However, you will find it often under the title The Handbook or Epictetus Handbook. And there are several versions available. There are some online versions that are free. However, if you actually want to go through the book, I highly recommend the Robin Hard translation, which is published by Oxford University World Classics. And it's called Epictetus Discourses, Fragments, and Handbook.
What's it called? The Handbook of what?
A Handbook for New Stoics. That's the book that I wrote with Greg. I'll put it in the chat. I'll put this stuff in the chat when we wrap up this discussion. I will answer a couple of questions. I saw a couple of questions in the chat, but of course I can't talk at the same time as typing. So before I log off, stay in the chat if you're interested, and I'll answer a couple of questions there.